Friends, welcome to E Pathshala in Linguistics. We are dealing with the section on typology. I am K.V. Subbarao. We are going to discuss today language universals, language typology, parametric variation, and the inductive versus deductive method. We will be talking about first the inductive versus the deductive method, then goals of typological studies, followed by parametric variation, then formulation of parameters in South Asian languages, and then we conclude our lecture. For the study of language universals, there are either you can follow the inductive method, very briefly I will mention these things, or the deductive method for arriving at linguistic universals. You can, in the inductive method, what you do is you collect an enormous amount of data and you try to formulate a universal based on the data, possibly without any reference to any framework. First, let us see what are universals. If you recall, John Robert Ross in 1967 formulated a set of island constraints on movement of constituents in a sentence. Some of these include the complex NP constraint or the complex noun phrase constraint, the coordinate structure constraint, etc. Chomsky subsequently proposed the subjacency constraint, which subsumes all these movement constraints. All these are universal principles in the sense that they are expected to be obeyed in all the languages of the world and there cannot be any exceptions. Then the question that we now wish to discuss is how to arrive at language universals. What could be a principled method? Though not explicitly stated, there are two approaches to the study of language universals: the inductive method and the deductive method. What exactly is an inductive method? What exactly is a deductive method? Let us take language teaching for example. In language teaching, one may either follow the inductive method or the deductive method or a combination of these two methods. So, you can give the data, that is, you can give the lesson after lesson, and expect the student to abstract the rules concerning a specific construction based on the data that is presented in the lesson. No explicit grammatic rule or principle per se is taught to the student in the classroom. Based on the text data that is presented, it is the student's responsibility to abstract the grammatical principle underlying the systematic lesson or data that is presented to him. So, this we can say is a kind of inductive way of doing things. In contrast, in the deductive method, the grammatical principle is introduced first with an explanation from the teacher and the lesson is introduced, which is based to explicate the principles. Thus, in the inductive method, one proceeds from data to theory, that is data to abstraction, while in the deductive method, one goes from theory to data. Now, so in the study of language universals, can this strict dichotomy be maintained? What is the difference in terms of inductive method and deductive method? In one of our papers, we have argued that it is the methodology that is adopted and it is the choice of data that is taken. This is the basic difference between the inductive method and the deductive method. Regarding the methodology adopted, it is generally argued that a deductivist starts with a postulation of a hypothesis, That is, you have the hypothesis first, whereas the inductivist starts with the observation of data, so data first, and it is from the data that he or she arrives at a generalization. This is a paper written in 1987 by Subbarao and Saxena. Notice that. So, what does the deductivist do? He starts with postulation of a hypothesis, and then inductivist observes the data and comes up with a generalization. Notice that to formulate a hypothesis, the deductivist as well as the inductivist have to have some sort of hypothesis. Although without having a hypothesis, if you collect data, the data may be relevant or data may not be relevant. So, to collect the relevant data, you should have a right kind of question. To have a right kind of question, you have to have some kind of hypothesis. So, hypothesis is a must either in data collection. It is, I would say, rather a prerequisite either for the inductive method or the deductive method. Why? Because it is the nature of the data, it is the nature of the hypothesis that dictates what type of data needs to be collected. Without a proper hypothesis, collecting data might prove to be a futile exercise. Then the question is, how to formulate a hypothesis? Can a hypothesis be formulated without a framework? Can a hypothesis be formulated in vacuum? The answer is no. Why? Isolated facts or hypotheses are relevant only when they are presented in a framework. So, you may have number of hypotheses, an n number of hypotheses, but these hypotheses, unless they are viewed from a framework, the hypothesis do not have any relevance. So, for an inductivist, if he has to formulate a hypothesis, he needs some sort of framework. For a deductivist, too, a deductivist working on language universals formulates a universal on the basis of the strength of the framework that he or she has formulated. Let me repeat this. It is argued that a deductivist formulates his hypothesis to work on language universals, and he formulates language universals on the basis of the strength of the framework that he or she has formulated. The question now is, under this assumption, it is the framework that provides him or her the power of prediction. Notice that a linguist evolves at a framework so that he or she can adequately account for the facts of the language, and the language universal that he or she formulates is based on the data that he or she uses, at least from one language. Without any database, one cannot simply formulate a universal. That is, if you want to formulate a universal, you have to have a database, at least of one or two languages. Thus, the universal that he formulates has a strong empirical or database. Unless he has a strong database, no universal can be formulated. Thus, formulation of any language universal requires not only the knowledge of one or two languages, but has to have insight from the framework that he or she has evolved, which again has a strong language basis. You cannot evolve a framework without having at least one language as a base. That is, there cannot be any deductive approach which is devoid of language or language data. Similarly, an inductivist, as we mentioned, cannot have any cannot formulate any hypothesis unless he has some kind of framework in mind. Thus, an inductivist requires some conceptual framework to enable him or her to formulate a sound hypothesis that enables him or her to arrive at a language universal. Hence, an inductivist is a micro deductivist. Similarly, a deductivist has to have a language base. Unless the language base is there, no formulation of any universal can take place. So, a deductivist is a micro inductionist. Thus, we can conclude that there is a symbiotic relationship between theory and data. They are inseparable. You cannot separate one from the other. Therefore, whether you are an inductivist or a deductivist, you have to have data and theory going hand in hand. One of the goals of the typological study should be to advance our understanding of the central theoretical questions of language. Thus, typology must focus on various phenomena of current theoretical and empirical relevance and must attempt to provide solutions supported by rich empirical data. So, what should a typologist do? He should choose data from a wide range of languages and analyze these data in a theoretical framework, and this is a must for any typological study. Any typological study that is done without any reference to any theory is not an adequate way of doing the typology. Thus, as we mentioned, there is a symbiotic relationship between linguistic theory and language typology, that is theory and data. So formal linguistic theory and linguistic typology are one and the same. They are not different, as Cinque in 2007 has observed. And in my works, in 1999, Subbarao, I have said that choosing from a wide range of data and analyzing them in a theoretical framework is a desideratum, where I have expressed similar opinion, where typology has to strike a balance between data and theory so that linguistically significant generalizations can be obtained. That is, we have to have a mid path. It should not be too theoretical, it should not be too data oriented, ignoring the theory. So, typology should be both data and theory oriented. According to Subbarao 2012, any theory that is proposed without a sound theoretical base and any theoretical claims made regarding nature of human language without a strong database will not be explanatorily adequate. We will now discuss parametric variation. All parameters are in terms of binary features, plus or minus. For example, take this parameter of word order, SOV and SOV, SVO. So, in the SOV languages, the verb comes in the final position. So, these are head final languages. And in the ornament and binding framework, case assignment takes from left to right. Whereas in SVO and VSO languages, the verb comes in the non-verb final position, and the case assignment in the government and binding framework is from left to right to left. So, this is a parameter of case assignment in terms of direction. The next parameter we discuss briefly is the prodrop parameter. Any noun phrase in a sentence can be prodropped, may it be the subject or the direct object, and we can I have discussed this in some other units, so I am not going to spend time on this. Now let us try to formulate some specific parameters, a couple of them, in South Asian languages. Dravidian languages except Malayalam and Tibeto-Burman language of the Kukijin family and some other Tibeto-Burman languages like Manipuri have a verbal as well as a nominal anaphor, and most of the Munda languages have only the verbal reflexive. So in Indo-Aryan languages there is no verbal reflexive, and languages which have a verbal reflexive do not permit long distance binding. Languages which have a verbal reflexive do not permit long distance binding, while languages which do not have a verbal reflexive may permit long distance binding. Let us take the case of Hindi. As you know, in Hindi you don't have a verbal anaphor, so is the case in all other Indo-Aryan languages. But at the same time, Hindi has a complex anaphor, that is apne aap type, or panun pan in Kashmiri, apne aap in Hindi, nije ke nije in Bangla, etc. So the parameter is, if we have a plus complex anaphor or a plus verbal anaphor, long distance binding is not permitted. If you have a minus complex anaphor, that is a simple anaphor, or no verbal anaphor, then long distance binding is permitted. I am not going to discuss these details now. You can look at Subba Rao 2012 for a discussion on this. That is, the occurrence of the complex anaphor and or verbal anaphor are negatively specified for the phenomenon of long distance binding. For example, let's take Hindi, Urdu. Ashok ne Lalita se chai banane ko apne liye chai banane ko kaha. That is, Ashok asked Lalita to make tea for self. Apne liye, for self, is the same in all three persons. That is, first person, second person, third person. That is, the verb, the nominal anaphor is not sensitive to person. So here in this sentence, Ashok asked Lalita to make some tea for himself, or for him, that is Ashok, or for herself, for Lalita. So this apne liye, which occurs in embedded clause, has a pro, because this is a non-finite clause, as a subject, and this can either be co-indexed with the embedded subject, with the indirect object, or with the matrix subject. In Telugu, notice that Telugu and the Tibeto-Burman languages, Kannada, Tamil, they have a verbal anaphor. If you have a verbal anaphor, you cannot have a verbal anaphor in the embedded clause, you cannot have long distance binding. Let's take sentence number 2. Prabhu, proper name, Prasunani, another proper name, accusative, Prasuna, accusative, Tanakosam, self for, Vanta, food, Vandukoman Jeppadu, asked her to make. This ko is a verbal reflexive in Telugu, and the ko occurs in the embedded clause. So Tanakosam, self for, cannot be co-indexed with the subject, because the verbal reflexive blocks long distance binding. If coreference is intended, then the verbal reflexive has to be dropped, as in sentence number 3. Prabhu, Prasunani, Tanakosam, Vanta, Vandamani Cheppadu. The ko is dropped. Vandamani Cheppadu, asked her to make food for him and not for herself. So we should stop here. So the point is, if you have a complex anapher or a verbal reflexive, then you cannot have long distance binding. If there is no complex anapher, if there is no verbal reflexive, you can have long distance binding. So if parameter is formulated in terms of plus or minus features. Thank you.